Vittorio, welcome to Equinix. It's really good to have you.
Thank you very much. It's a pleasure to be here.
Listen, I would quickly want to start with you explaining a little bit about who you are and what you do with Oracle.
Absolutely. My name is Vittorio Garbuio, and I am a head of Multicloud at Oracle.
Multicloud Oracle, right. That's comes in quite handy because that is our subject for today. We really want to talk about what we see happening in multi-cloud. In Equinix, we've been doing something that's called the Global Interconnection Index. And we've been doing that for a number of years, which also enables us to see trends, to actually make predictions. We've done some predictions that came true, right? So we're super interested in what that shows for the next year. And what we do is we look at the interconnections of companies with their service providers, companies with each other, service providers amongst each others, and we see huge growth. And that means also that we see ecosystems developing more and more. And one of the statistics, and specifically pertaining to multi-cloud, that we've seen over the last years, and that we actually can predict. So we can see that by 2026, of global 2,000 companies, about 80% of those companies will have interconnections to four or more of the hyperscalers. Talk about multi-cloud, right? As well as to 30 or more of their SaaS providers or their partners or all that stuff. So that's what we see happening, and we, from the trends we see, we know that's where we'll be by 2026. Mm-hmm. About 85% of those companies will have these multi-cloud interconnections in multiple regions. So not just where they started or next to their head offices or whatever, but they will actually have scaled in a way that they have this throughout the world. Mm-hmm. And really, that shows a lot about where we already see that the multi-cloud is going. But before we step into that and really see what your viewpoints and your experiences are there, I would like to maybe take a step back and talk about Oracle's distributed cloud infrastructure, your mm-hmm. OCI service, and your view on that and how you position that into the IT landscape of today.
Yes, absolutely. As you have stated, research tells us that more than 80% of the organizations will be using multiple clouds for mixing and matching different services from the different clouds. They're going towards an internet of clouds, if you will, right, where they can use the best of breed from different cloud service providers. However, as you have stated, there are many companies who have been still running their mission-critical workloads on premises. And that's for a variety of reasons, if you will, right? Including performance, security, data regulatory, et cetera.
Yeah,
and with this in mind, in fact, we architected the Oracle Cloud Infrastructure Distributed Cloud, which provides companies with the freedom to choose where deploy their workloads, whether it will be in the public clouds or using cloud services on premises or mixing the different cloud service providers.
Yep.
With OCI Cloud, Oracle Cloud Infrastructure Distributed Cloud, we offer a whole range of services which go beyond the public cloud services. Today we have something around 48 regions across the globe, but beyond that we offer hybrid cloud capabilities which allow our companies to deploy cloud services along with their innovation and the cloud business model on premises.
Yep.
And by doing so, customers can then address challenges, including performance, security, data residency, and governance, etc. And then finally, we have the multi-cloud services. As you stated, we do know that the vast majority of the organizations across the globe have been already using two or more cloud service providers. And we think at Oracle that cloud service providers must take the responsibility in building multi-cloud solutions, which would be allowing our customers to deploy multi-cloud architectures and interoperate between clouds in a seamless way.
Yeah. That is so refreshing to hear, from a cloud service provider themselves, from a hyperscaler, simply saying this is there, right, and we acknowledge it and we have the responsibility to make sure that that customers can use multi-cloud in that way. I think it's very refreshing, and it's a sound that you know, from my perspective, I'm super happy that is actually coming up, that kind of statement from, you know, the likes of yourselves. That's great. So when we talk about multi-cloud anyhow, of course, you're seeing it. So can you talk about some of the use cases that you see for multi-cloud today?
Yes, absolutely. We have been seeing, you know, many use cases, but maybe I can summarize them in three main categories. The first category includes the most simple ones, right, which are about backup and restore, using a secondary cloud for backup and restore
sure.
data.
Yes.
The second category is the one regarding the customers who have been using a secondary cloud for disaster recovery purposes, right? Whether that would be an active disaster recovery or active passive.
Yeah.
And then we have been seeing many customers who have been running full stack applications in different clouds and sharing data across the clouds in a seamless way, as well as many customers have been using split stack applications right across the clouds, whereby the application tier runs in one cloud and the data tier in the secondary cloud.
To me, that is actually really, really interesting, because that's one of the promises that we've always talked about. Yeah, multi-cloud, you should be able to run multi-tier and your front end there and your back end there. And the fact that it's actually there, that really excites me, right?
But, absolutely.
Yeah, but as always, you know, these things do not go by itself. There must be challenges and you know, that we face when we want to build that kind of architecture.
Absolutely. While multi-cloud solutions are great, right, for an operational standpoint, but they come inevitably with multiple challenges. Mm-hmm. These include typically the management, right, managing workloads across the cloud,
yeah.
As well as security, and then obviously connectivity, right? As we all know, interconnecting different clouds could be very, very tricky. Mm-hmm. And that's why, you know, providers like Equinix come into play. You are a specialist in helping, you know, customers in doing this,
yeah.
right?
Yeah, I would say that we are, right? And it's something we've seen for a long time, that this demand was there. And I think if we talk about that particular element, it would be good to simply, you know, go back a few years, you know, when all the service cloud service providers started their services. What we always saw is that the first way to a public cloud is almost always using the internet, right? So you build an IPsec VPN and you connect your multiple clouds together like that, and that's how you start. That's how you try. And you prove your concept and you sort of see that it works. And you know, at some point the internet is simply not good enough anymore. It can be for several reasons. You touched on that, right? It might be security. It might be that, you know, it's not always trustworthy. It might also simply be a performance thing. It might even be a money thing, right? With data egress and that kind of stuff. So what we then saw happening is that all the cloud service providers realized that and started to develop private connectivity products into their services. And yours is called FastConnect. It's been there for a long time and it's proven its value. And all of your competitors or, you know, the other cloud service providers have similar products. Mm-hmm. The thing is, though, that if you want to use those, you know, those dedicated connections to the cloud, you sort of, you know, the onus is on you as an enterprise, basically, to do that physical interconnection. And very funnily, what we saw in the early years is that, you know, while they were consuming cloud services, you know, on the go, and they had to come in and, you know, put in a physical device to connect these services together. And that's, of course, not the concept of public cloud. You know, it has to be on demand. So here we saw basically one of our purposes in life is to enable that in a virtual way, mm-hmm. which is what we did. And the choice we made is to do that with different vendors out there that have a name in networking services already, because, you know, our customers know these vendors, like a Cisco, or you want to have a routing device there, or you want to have a Palo Alto firewall,
sure.
or Juniper SRX, or you use AVATrix to do your multi-cloud networking, or, you know, you want to stick in a little bit of SD-WAN, or, you know, all of these things that you would traditionally do with a physical device. So what we set out to do is to enable that virtually. So we built a platform for those vendors to come. And that's what we really have today, right? So we enable these multi-cloud architectures by the vendors that they really know. It is on demand, right? It is automatable, all the things that you really would want to see, and, you know, and no assets. So you want to build your multi-cloud architecture and you need to do this difficult connectivity piece, you know, it's there for you. And that's something that I really am sure that, that benefits both of us.
Absolutely. Yeah. And then, what about your latest service, right? Which is a pure multi-cloud service, isn't it?
Yes, it is. Well, it's really something we must talk about. But you know, before we do, let me take a quick step back, because there is definitely a slide that I want to see about such an architecture that already lives today, which is a real example about an ERP solution in Oracle and using AWS for some of the application and also some of the front-end services. And this is one that runs in the States. It's a pharma company, and they have done exactly this. They've said, right, we want this to be a tiered application across multiple clouds. We don't want any assets. How do we do this? And that today is solved with a simple, relatively simple, redundant Cisco solution in the middle based on the platform that we just discussed.
And this is one of many examples, if I may, right?
Well, if it were just one example, right? But there's many, of course, right? It's really not just with AWS, but it's, of course, also with Google, with Ali, with IBM, with Azure. We all have those examples, and they're not just in the US, right? It is really, we're seeing that it's pervasive meanwhile. So this is really there. But going back to your original question, why this new product? As always, when you build and you develop a product, you always see that there's a few things that you might have missed or that are just not there. And so there's two things really that we might not be able to do optimally with the current product set. The one is the simplicity. So if I really, really only need to connect two clouds or three clouds together, and I don't need that rich feature set that a vendor would offer, but I really need to do this and I need to do it fast, so then we don't really have a solution for that. Or we used to not have a solution for that. We do now, right? And the other one is the really high capacity use cases. And because the platform we built so far, there's a little bit of off-box technology with that, which means that there is a limitation in capacity. So if you really want to profit from that full capacity, you have to build something that is intrinsic and lives inside your switching architecture, which is also what we did right now. So this is called Fabric Cloud Router, and it does exactly that. It's simple and it offers high capacity exactly to enable these multi-cloud use cases. And of course, it's automatable, it's on demand, and it's there. The good thing is, since it's within our platform, it is available everywhere right away. Right? We don't have to build separate stacks to enable this solution.
Excellent. I love this simplicity, right? Which is key, which helps us to demystify the complexity of multi-cloud, if you will, right?
Yeah, it does, right? And basically using similar Terraform libraries that you would use to set up, setups in Oracle Cloud or any other cloud, you could use a similar library to enable that and spin up or spin down or spin out or, the cloud connectivity, the multi-cloud connectivity that you need.
Absolutely.
So this is the latest gain in basically multi-cloud technology on the networking side, obviously. The partnership between Oracle and Equinix is really an interesting one. It's really a special one, because we've seen that in the stats, early in this talk, of course, that this is not something that you want to do as a company in just one place, right? Once you've built a working multi-cloud architecture, you want to expand that, and you want to do that in the places in the world where you really need it. And that's really why you need this kind of a global partnership that we have. And I have to show the slide where we are together, right? And it's 30 plus places in the world, multiple data centers, where this FastConnect comes into into Equinix facilities, and where we can really build this kind of solutions based on the use cases that that you've addressed. And then there's one last slide. Really, it is a multicolor slide, right? It has a lot of nice boxes in it. And if you see the slide, right, you might not really know what it means. But if we're talking hyperscaler, we're really talking, six, I guess, globally, right? So it's you guys, it's Azure, it's Google, it's AWS. It's probably Ali and IBM to an extent. So what we really have tried globally is to get as many as possible of these on-ramps, as we call them, these cloud access nodes, into our facilities so that we can really enable these infrastructures. And the last slide shows actually how many we have today in multiple metros. So it shows that there's really a lot of places in the world that we can actually build these architectures.
Facilitate these architectures.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Yeah, well, actually, that's a good word. We facilitate them in the end, right? I mean, you build them in your clouds and we facilitate this interconnection component.
Wow, that's great, honestly.
Yeah, it's not something we're not really, we are really proud of that. But again, it doesn't come without partnership. because this is not something that we can do on our side. It does require you guys to realize and to see, you know, the need for this and to work with us to get this done.
Absolutely.
Well, Victoria, thank you very much. I super enjoyed it. You know, the subject of multi-cloud, as we discussed, right, it is really there. It's not something that, you know, used to be talked about. You know, I want to give our viewers just a little bit a teaser to go on. And there's an email address here that if you have questions around how we do these things together with Oracle at Equinix, by all means. And of course, we have to do a little bit of publicity for the cloud router. There's a QR code there. You know, if you're already, by the way, an Equinix user, you can just go on the portal, play with it. There's a free tier and go try it out. Otherwise, you know, use the QR code. Anything you want to add to that from the Oracle side?
I just want to thank you very much for being here and discuss multi-cloud, which is a topic which we are passionate about.
Yes.
So it's been really a pleasure to be here. And yeah, likewise, we do provide our free assessment when it comes to multi-cloud. So you can just use the QR which is in the slide, mm-hmm. and we can provide this assessment. So looking forward to see you.
To multiple customers. Thank you very much and see you soon.
Thank you very much.
Bye.